Last couple of weeks, we've been speaking about the love of God. 2 weeks ago, we spoke about love is the language of heaven. And then last week, we spoke about God's love. Love is the motivation force behind everything God has ever done for us. And today, I want to just share on another subject, but I want to talk a little bit about faith. Because the Bible says, you know, though we have faith and though we can move mountains and though we can do this and do not have love, we're like clanging cymbals. But he also says in the word, without faith, it is impossible to please God. So we don't do away with love and we don't do away with faith. We don't do away with anything, but we embrace them. And we allow that we can love and we can have faith in God as well. Your faith really is the spark that ignites the impossible. Never underestimate the power of faith. I want to just say that again. Your faith is the spark that ignites the impossible. If you're looking for something impossible, that's impossible in the natural to happen, it won't happen by hoping, but your faith, your believing can be the spark that will ignite something in the realm of the Spirit that would cause heaven to open, that would cause the power of God to come in on your behalf, and signs and wonders and miracles will happen. Never underestimate the power of faith. How you think will affect how you believe or what you believe. How you think will allow you to move or not move with the unlimited power of God. See, what we've got to understand is that God is all-powerful. Jesus is all-powerful, amen? God has given you everything that pertains to life and to godliness. He has endued you with power from on high. But because we suffer lack in our lives, that doesn't mean that God suffers lack. God is all-powerful. But it's how you think, how you think will cause your believing to either overcome or be overcome. How you think will allow you to move or not move with the unlimited power of God. I cannot underestimate that word. I cannot overestimate that word. I cannot express the magnitude and the power that it contains, but the unlimited power of God. When we realize that God fashioned the worlds by a word, He made it out of nothing. We've got to allow our imagination to grasp that God. Not the God of the natural. Not a God that restricts, but a God where there's everything is unlimited. Is anything too hard for God? Nothing is too hard for God, amen? It's okay for you to talk to me now and then. Your thinker, your brain, your computer. What's been programmed in your thinking will establish your level of faith. If you've been told all your life you'll never achieve, you'll never accomplish, you'll never make it, you're no good, and things like that, and you come into agreement with that, that is the level that you will operate on. And so when you hear about the awesome things that God does, whether it be a miracle, whether it be somebody that's healed, your natural mind will always go to a natural outcome. You will not even be able, you most probably even think, that really never happened. You listen to some of the TV programs, some of the documentaries, and you know, 400 million years ago, man, it's just in their thinking, that's the way they've been programmed and that's the way they think. And then they look at something there that God has created and they've got no answer for the way it's been created. The minute detail that causes one thing to cause another thing to, you know, just the reaction of creation itself. And yet somehow or other they think that some millions and millions of years ago humanity crawled out of a swamp. because it's the way they've been programmed. And what we've got to do is we've got to program ourselves with the Word of God. And that's why we've got to speak to ourselves daily or every moment of the day. Nothing is too difficult for God. Whatever circumstance I'm facing, whatever's going through, there's nothing too hard for God. God will make a way. If I can only trust and obey, and if I can only just believe God. Your thinker, your brain, your computer will establish your level of faith. If you don't think it's going to happen, it most probably won't happen. Your thinker is very, very important. Luke 24, 49 says, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high." I want you to do something. I want you to tarry. To receive the promise of the Father. In this particular case, it was power. But today, I would believe that there are many things that we are believing for. Some might be believing for health. Some might be believing for finance. Somebody might be believing for a lost family member or other things. But whatever it is, we are to tarry. The word tarry means to wait. We need to tarry. We need to wait upon. You may say to me today, "I've been waiting a long time." That's not what the word wait means. The word wait here means to wait with expectancy. I want everybody to say that word, expectancy. Expectancy. If we can be in a position where we're waiting upon God, but we're in our heart, we're saying, we know that this is possible and we know that it's going to happen. And so you're waiting with expectancy, you're believing, you don't lose hope, you don't lose faith, you don't allow the enemy to steal from you, you don't allow him to destroy your life. To tarry, to wait. Now God at times moves supernaturally, beyond our wildest dreams. So there's a difference here when you are believing for something and all of a sudden when you're not even believing for something, it happens. Anybody ever had something that you've never expected happen and it happened and you've just been blessed out of your socks? But have you ever had something unexpectedly happen to you that you weren't even praying for, you weren't even really believing for, but God just blessed you anyhow, amen? So God does move supernaturally and he does move like that. But basically, what God wants is as we believe when we're expecting that God is going to do something for us. Amen? The Bible says have faith in God or have the God kind of faith. You know what? God believes that he will have a church that the gates of Hades will not prevail against. Can I say that again? God really believes that he is going to have a church that is all powerful. He really believes that he's going to have a church that are going to know the power of God, that no weapon formed against them will prosper. He really believes he's going to have a church. You see, God is faith. And he is going to have a church that will cast out demons, lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. That if they pick up any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. He's going to have a church that, you know, nothing can harm us, amen. I believe that God is that sort of God. God is a faith God. And really, if you look at the circumstances and the situations when God spoke these words, it didn't look like it was ever going to be possible because the church was in a mess. But he said, "I will build my church and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give them power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the works of Satan, and nothing shall by any means hurt them." God has faith that this will come to pass. So friends, what we've got to do is while we're tarrying, we tarry with an expectancy. Now, somebody like me will drive you crazy because I have got a one-track mind that the church will rule and reign on this planet as God said it would. And I will continue to speak this while I have breath. Because there's an expectancy on the inside of me. We walked into that prayer meeting today. I wanted to take the whole church into that little back room. The electronic fire, the power, the manifestation of God was so electric. Am I talking truth for those that were there? I come out of that room. I don't know if I was touching the parquetry floor. Because it was electric, it was tangible. And friend, I want to tell you, once you've had a tangible touch of the Master's hand, there's something on the inside of you that hungers for it, that longs for it, that will push through whatever you've got to push through to get hold of it, amen. The dynamic power of God. God is a faith God. Have faith in God, or have the God kind of faith. God believes he will have this church that he said he's going to have. You and I have faith, but God is faith. He doesn't have faith, he is faith. God's presence and anointings comes upon all, but some he rests upon. I'm talking about what separates people. What causes God to go over 6 or 10 people to touch that one? What causes God to do things? I don't know about you, but I want to be the one that gets the touch, amen? Yes, amen. And if you're sitting there, there's a good chance he might go past. But if there's something on the inside of you that's crying out, there's a good chance he'll come on you. Amen. He'll rest on you. He'll rest on you. How many people want him to rest on you? Settle upon you. It's your passion that will cause him to separate you from others. It's his passion. I've told this story many, many times, but as I was preparing this message, it came afresh on me and it did something on the inside of me that put, again, something there. When I've been saved for a period of time, but I was still very, very self-centered. Pleased myself, just worked for me. There came a time as I started to grow a bit in God, grow up a little bit in God, from a child to an adolescent to a youth to growing into adulthood, starting to find God in a different way and starting to hear God a little bit differently and starting to want God a little bit more. There came a time when they were asking for children's church helpers to help at this camp that they were going to have. And I remember putting my hand up as a volunteer. Yes, I'll go and help. I had no interest in children. I had really no desire or anything like that, but I just wanted to do something for God. I wanted to yield myself a bit. So I put my hand up. They knew me, and they knew that I really didn't have a lot of godliness around me. I was still a rookie. They gave me the job in the kitchen, peeling the pumpkin and the potatoes. But I can remember as the shutter of the kitchen was open and the saw the children, the teachers there and teaching them. You see, When you put yourself in a place, God can start to work on you. You can't say, I'm waiting over here, God, and if you, here I am, if you want me, I'm over here. Glory to God, God's gift of God. I'm be okay. No, you got to start to respond. Is that a good word? You got to start to respond and start to step out a little bit and start to give of yourself a bit more. Instead of making excuses, put up your hand. So I went. I'm watching these children, first day, second day, third day. Of an evening, we would go out and we'd pray under the stars. This particular night, we're out there. And somehow or other, God was doing something in me, and I just started to feel a burden for these children. I got out under the stars and I threw my hands in the air and I didn't know who else was there. I didn't care. I just walking around under the stars, crying out for these kids, crying out. And all of a sudden, heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Something from heaven came all over me. And I want to tell you, friends, it's never ever left me. That night, I was totally changed. Well, not totally, a little bit. Still had a lot more to do. But I remember it well. I remember the anointing. I remember the presence of God. That's what birthed the children's church that David and Hazel helped us build. How many kids that we see get saved, healed, delivered, today that are still serving Jesus in the ministry somewhere, somehow. What I'm talking about is when that anointing comes upon you, it's never ever left. Your passion will get God's attention. That passion for those children started to grow, and then a passion for souls. Phil and Annette over there were of others over there. Would have remembered the days at the gatehouse, the days at the pineapple shed, the days when we saw literally hundreds and hundreds of people coming and getting born again. Week after week after week, you get a passion for souls. And then you start to grow and you develop, and there's something else that started to come. I got a passion for worship. Friend, I don't care. I will worship Him. I will talk in tongues. I'll worship Him in the natural and I'll worship Him in the spirit. If you want to come along for the greatest ride you can ever have, let's get on board, amen. And let's worship. Get a passion for worship. I'm not talking about just singing a lullaby. I'm talking about a passion. A passion. That when the song, I'm 77, but I'll jump in the air. I'll suffer in the morning. Is it okay to be honest? Talk like this? Because you see, if we're going to stay here, we'll just stay here and do the same old, same old. But if we want to move into something so dynamic and so powerful, we're going to have to start stepping out. We're going to have to start moving. And in our prayer meeting this morning, the Spirit of God started to say, arise and shine and stand tall, hallelujah. Stand up strong, lift up your head. I'm not a wimp. I'm a child of God, amen. I am not ashamed of this gospel. It is the power of God unto salvation. Got plenty of time yet. Passion for worship, passion for souls. I want to just share a little bit about a facet of Jesus that might help us see Jesus in a way that will allow us to approach Him with confidence and expectancy. Jesus, the Son of God, came from heaven to earth to a horrible death to redeem mankind. I tried to, in my imagination, think of Jesus in heaven. The grandeur of heaven, the majesty of heaven. What is heaven in your imagination? Bible speaks about a time it speaks about a situation where God, Jesus, on the throne, surrounded by 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands and thousands. And friend, this is how I've got to, in my mind and in my imagination, if I'm going to break the smallness of my mind and my ability to think, I've got to break it by the grandeur. And I see my Jesus sitting with 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands upon thousands crying with a loud voice. What did he cry? Holy, 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 worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. And here is Jesus in this circumstance, in this situation, and he's going to leave 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands upon thousands to come down to this planet to be spat upon, to be rejected, to be despised. Friend, that's how much God loves you. That's how much God loves us and cares for us. Amen. But it even gets better. He left heaven to go to Hades. Isaiah 53. We all know it so well. But I want to read it so I get it properly. Verse 3. He left heaven. Can you catch my drift this morning? Where he was honored and respected and holy, 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 worthy is the Lamb. And he came down to this. Verse 3, he is despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. And we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we were healed. We all were like sheep have gone astray. Friend, I want to tell you, if there was one little bit of humanity in that man, he would have looked at us and looked at where he was sitting in heaven and looked at humanity and would have said, I'm not going down there. How many people are so glad that God's not like us? But you know what? He wants us to become like him. We've all got to shift, haven't we? We've all got to move. We've all got to do something. We've all got to change. He poured his life out into his 12 disciples while he was on this planet. The 12 disciples saw him heal all who were oppressed of the devil. In fact, Jesus taught his disciples to demonstrate the power of love and God. To demonstrate his power and his love. They heard him say as he hung on the cross, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Friend, what can separate us from the love of God? The only thing that can separate you from the love of God is wrong thinking. I've seen so many people destroy their lives through wrong thinking. Anybody else? Wrong talk. Friend, we've got a God who loves us so much. I would love to be able to have the vocabulary, to be able to express what I'm feeling on the inside. This is not a message. This is me. Trying to understand how much God really loves me. So I will think right. I want you to have a quick look with me in John chapter 20. After the resurrection, he revealed himself to his disciples. Thomas wasn't there, and when he was told that they'd seen the Lord, he didn't believe, and he said, unless I can touch him. That's in John 20, 24. 8 days later, he came again. Can you believe it that it's too much of me and me. But if Thomas would have said that, I would have said, bite your beak. The boys said they saw me, that should be enough. But you said, unless I can put my finger in his hand and in his side, I won't believe. You know what? God came 8 days later and he walked straight up to Thomas. How many times has he walked up the kneel and said, okay, thrust your hand in my side then. Okay, and I'll show you I really love you. Okay. When we didn't deserve it. When we didn't deserve it. Thomas didn't deserve it. Didn't deserve it. What an amazing story here. What an amazing story. And he goes in and he touches him. I'm just going to go into John 21. I'm going to use a little bit of preacher's license here. Because at this point of time, Jesus has already been resurrected. He said to the man on the cross, he said, today you'll be in paradise with me. He said to Mary Magdalene, she came up to him, she said, do not embrace me because I have not been back to my Father yet. Which indicates to me that Jesus, when he was resurrected, went back into that heavenly realm. But his love for you, man, you think, man, you think it's a man, whew, praise God, it's done, it's finished, hallelujah, that's enough. But no, because he could see the harassment, the disappointment, the confusion, the mess that the church was in. His disciples were in a mess. There was threats of being killed. There was all this mess going on around their lives. Satan was having a field day. There are people in this building that Satan's been having a field day in your life. Harassing you, destroying your life. But he loves us so much that he came back and he started to show himself again so that people could have confidence that he had risen from the dead. And this story amazes me. And verse 21, it says, after these things, Jesus showed himself again to disciples. This is the third time at the Sea of Tiberias. And in this way, he showed himself to Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael, Cana in Galilee, the son of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. You gotta catch this. Here's Jesus. He's just paid the price, wounded for their transgression, bruised for their iniquity. The chastisement of their peace was upon him. He's risen from the dead. He's gone into Hades. He's copped a lot. He's risen from the dead. He's gone back to his Father and been glorified. I want to tell you, friends, they would have ushered him in. The elders, goodness knows what, there would have been trumpets. There would have been a sound, shouts of praise. Hallelujah. All those that had died in faith, believing in Jesus, that had seen what he'd done, how he'd annihilated Satan and raised from the dead. Glory to God. Here he is. That would have been a shout of praise in heaven. Hallelujah. But he looks down and he sees the mess. Friend, I want to tell you, what can separate you from the love of God? Only your wrong thinking. God's watching over us. He's looking over us right now in heaven. He's watching in heaven as we down here are preaching our heart out, worshiping, loving God. What do you think he's saying? He's saying, come on, Father. Come on, they're looking for us. They're wanting me. Come on, pour it out on them. If there's no expectancy in there, there's nothing. If there's no effort, there's nothing. Everything that we do is going to take effort, amen. And here he is, he looks down at his disciples that he's poured his life into. And Peter says, I'm going fishing. In other words, what he's saying, I'm going back to my old life. How many people today are wandering around out there going back to their own life that once knew Jesus with a passion? I want to tell you, Jesus is watching over them. He's going to draw them back. He's going to bring them back, amen. And here is Jesus. He said, I'm going fishing. And guess what all the other boys said? We're going with you. We're going with you. You know, if there was just 1 ounce of me and him, he would have said, well, go your own way. That's what you want, go. I've got a short fuse. Anybody else got one of them? But no. No. We're going fishing. So they go down, they get in the boat, and they go out. And they work all night. I would have said, serve yourself right. Aren't you glad I'm not Jesus? Serve yourself right. You know, some people that are basing themselves in self-pity. No, come on, get out of it. Jesus wants to help you through it. He wants to make you more than a conqueror in it. And here are these guys, I'm going fishing. They said to him, we're going with you. They went out and immediately got into the boat. And that night they caught nothing. And when the morning had come, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Whatever you're going through, friend, Jesus is standing on the shore. He's standing on your shore waiting for you to come in. And Jesus said to them, children, have you any food? I'm a bit of a fisherman. I know what it's like to go fishing all night and catch nothing. I know what it's like to be wet and tired and cold and miserable. Hey, any of you like that? Can you imagine it? They're going through enough as it is. With the disappointment, they thought Jesus was going to establish the kingdom again. They thought he was going to wipe out the Roman Empire. They thought he was going to wipe out everything that needed to be wiped out and establish his kingdom. And they were going to sit there arguing, who's going to sit on your right and who's going to sit on your left? Who's going to do this? Who's going to be great? Hallelujah! Poof, gone. I'm going fishing. You got no idea how many Monday mornings I say that, I'm going fishing. gone fishing. There they were all night. They'd worked all night. They're cold. They're hungry. They're miserable. And Jesus is standing on the shore. Hey, kids, you got any food? Caught anything? Listen, I want you to get a picture of this Jesus. Have you any food? They answered him, no. I would have had a lot of O's on mine. No. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat and you shall find some. You know, they started their ministry this way, didn't they? This is how God really got their attention. Now he's getting their attention again. They didn't say, hey, we've worked all night. They shut up this time. They're starting to learn. So they cast the net and were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it's the Lord. Turn to somebody and whisper it to him. It's the Lord. It's the Lord. It's the Lord that's around you right now. It's the Lord. Peter put on his outer garment, for he removed it and plunged into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits, dragging the net with fish. And as soon as they'd come to land, they saw a fire of coals where the fish laid on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you have just caught. Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to land full of large fish, 153. And although there were so many, the net was not broken. And Jesus said to them, come and eat breakfast. Come and eat breakfast. This is the King of Glory. This is the Majesty on high. This is the Lord of Lords. God. And God comes down to a bunch of, what I want to call them, rebellious, whatever you want to call them, and cooks them breakfast. What, I want to ask you again, what can separate us from the love of God? What can separate us from receiving our answers? But friend, you will not receive your answer if we're complaining. You'll receive your answer when you know that he loves you so much that he will cook you breakfast. Cook your breakfast. Father, help us. Help us, Lord. Though the word says we come boldly before the throne of grace, but we come full of respect and honor. And we honor the majesty of our God, and we honor who you really are, and how much you really love us, and how much you want to move on our behalf, and how much you want to do that which we need. And Father, today, right now, help us. Help us. Help us. Help us. Help us.